Hi everyone, my name is Ajua, and in this protocol we're looking at RNA extraction from cultured cells. So you want to start off by harvesting your cells, and it's usually a great idea to put the cells into a 15 or 50 mil Falcon tube. This is because you need to pellet out the cells before we can go on with the next step. So sometimes you may be starting with cells that were frozen previously. That's fine. You can also use frozen cells in RNA extraction using TRIzol. So you can go ahead and thaw the cells on ice until it's fully thawed. Now we're going to use the reagent that will allow us to extract nucleic acid from the cells. This time we're using a reagent called TRIzol. TRIzol is composed of the main reagent is phenol and guanidine isothiocyanate, and these help to lyse cells and inactivate RNases. But there are other components. So there is ammonium thiocyanate, and this enhances protein denaturation and separation. There is also sodium acetate. This helps in phase separation during the RNA precipitation. And there is glycerol. This stabilizes the solution. And then there are pH adjusters such as hydrochloric acid or sodium hydroxide to maintain the pH and promote RNA stability. So once you've harvested the cells, you want to spin it down in order to remove the cellular fraction from the media that it was grown in. And so here you can pellet it at 500 by G for 5 minutes or more. And here you want to be relatively gentle, and that's why I'm suggesting 500 by G. You could probably spin higher, maybe up to 1500 by G, and that would allow you to gently pellet out the cells. And once you've pelleted out the cells, you can go ahead and remove the supernatant, which would just be the media and growth factors that were in the media. Interestingly, you actually don't want to wash the cells before adding your TRIzol. And so here what you see is my fraction of cells, cultured cells that were frozen at minus 80. It was thawed on ice. And then I went ahead and spun it in order to collect the pellet, the cell culture pellet. And so then I added 1 mL of TRIzol for every 250 microliters of sample. You want to add 1 mL of TRIzol. And as you can see, I had less than 250 microliters. So I added 1 mL of TRIzol. And what you want to also do is to measure how many cells you're using in each extraction. So it's recommended that you use 5 to 10 million cells for the extraction, and that way you can quantify how much RNA you have based on the number of cells that you put in. So you add 1 mL of TRIzol per 250 microliters of cell pellet. And so after addition of your TRIzol, you want to pipette up and down in order to homogenize the cells. So you just do it several times. If you're starting off with tissue, that's also okay, but you just would probably need, well, it's recommended you use a mechanical homogenizer to first break open the tissue and release the cells. And then while you're homogenizing, then the cells will also be broken up in the TRIzol solution. So just so you know, you can actually stop at this point after homogenization of the TRIzol reagent with your cell culture or tissue sample, and you can store it at 4 degrees overnight and then come back the next day and continue if for some reason you can't continue. Or you can store it at minus 20 degrees Celsius for up to a year, which is excellent. And it's not even if you can't continue. Sometimes you've just got a precious sample and you want to be able to do some work with it later on, RNA work with it later on, you can just go ahead and straight away preserve it in some kind of TRIzol reagent so that you can actually inactivate the RNases and have it be stabilized for you for when you're ready for using the RNA. So once you've homogenized it, you're going to add chloroform. For every mil of TRIzol, you want to add 200 microliters of chloroform. And you're going to vortex this for about 15 seconds to make it sure that it's fully suspended.
The chloroform is actually what allowed the phase separation, allows you to separate out your proteins and lipids away from the RNA and DNA. And so the chloroform is added and then centrifuged in order to obtain three distinct layers. You will get an aqueous layer, which is where the RNA will be, then an interface, which contains DNA, and then your organic solvent phase, your organic phase, which will be the bottom layer. That's also red because it has the phenol. And this contains proteins and lipids. Once you've added the chloroform, you want to wait 2 to 3 minutes and just let it incubate in the sample before proceeding to the next step. After waiting 2 to 3 minutes, you can centrifuge at fairly high speed, so 12,000 by G, for 15 minutes at 4 degrees Celsius. We want to keep the RNA protected, so we do it at a cooler temperature. Because previous to that, we've done everything at room temperature. So as discussed, you're now going to have a sample where the mixture has separated into three distinct phases. Your first phase or your lower phase is the phenol chloroform phase. Then the middle one is the lipid and protein, the lipid phase, DNA as well. And then the last phase, the top layer, is a colorless upper aqueous layer that has the RNA. So you want to transfer the colorless aqueous layer into a new tube, and we're going to go ahead with cleaning it up. So if you're interested in DNA, then you want to separate out the middle layer, which will have lipids as well as DNA. If you're interested in proteins, you can go ahead and take the red layer, the phenol organic layer, and you can actually go ahead and follow specific instructions to obtain protein from that. And I've actually been able to extract protein from that in the past for mass spec, following a mass spectrometry specific preparation of the proteins to make it compatible. So it's worth it if you want to be able to get all these molecules, biomolecules, from the one sample. Since this is about RNA extraction, we're going to go ahead and take the aqueous layer, and we're going to add isopropanol, 500 microliters of isopropanol for the 1 mL of TRIzol that we had added. And so here we want to invert it gently in order to mix it. And then we're going to just incubate it for 10 minutes at 4 degrees before we go ahead and centrifuge the prep. And again, we want to use high speed centrifugation, so we're doing at 12,000 by G for 10 minutes, and it's at a cooler temperature, so once again at 4 degrees Celsius. Now, before I go on and tell you why we do the isopropanol addition, can you spot the RNA in this prep? Can you spot it? Okay, if you can't, please let me know in the comment by just typing no. So the point of the isopropanol is to allow the DNA to precipitate out of solution so that it can be isolated and washed in subsequent steps. The RNA is not as soluble in alcohol as it is in water. So when you add the isopropanol, the RNA will precipitate out of the solution. And that way you have, yeah, just the nucleic acid, the RNA, and go ahead and clean it up. And so you want to be able to see the RNA, but if you can't see it, depending on how many cells you used in the extraction, to be honest, often I can't see my RNA, but don't worry, the RNA is there. I've gone on to quantitate my RNA in multiple occasions when I couldn't see anything. Like in this one that you're looking at, I actually quantified it by the nanodrop, which is a spectral photometer that's commonly in labs. And I was able to get 130 nanogram per microliter of RNA according to the quantitation. And of course, the nanodrop tends to exaggerate how much you have because it's not as specifically only looking at the RNA. If there's DNA or single-stranded DNA, it will still classify that as RNA. But it gives you an idea that there was definitely stuff RNA there. But yes, you can see the tube. It's not easy to see it. So a tip here is that you can make sure that the hinge of your tube is outside when you're centrifuging. Facing outward. And so when you centrifuge, the pellet that is there, even though you can't see it, will form towards the hinge of the Eppendorf tube or whatever tube you're using. And so when you go to aspirate the isopropanol to throw it away, you will avoid the hinge because you know that's where it is, even though you can't see it. So it's a good tip. Otherwise, people tend to put a reagent called glycogen. It's a carrier, and so this will actually be able to bind the RNA and give you a visual signal that it's there. And the great thing about the glycogen is that when you're then doing your downstream application, your other things that you're using the RNA for, it's inert and won't react and won't cause any problems. It's just a visual aid. But if your input was large and you are going to see a pellet, then it will be a white gel-like pellet at the bottom. So you want to go ahead and aspirate the supernatant. Well, not the super. Yeah, the supernatant, which is isopropanol in this case, and discard it. And so then we want to wash the RNA. Now, incidentally, this is also a safe stopping point. And it's actually recommended that if you're not going to use the RNA straight away, RNA is quite unstable, so if you're not going to use it straight away, you can actually leave it in this 75% ethanol reagent. You can store it in the fridge for about a week and it will be fine. Or you can even store it in the freezer at minus 20 for up to a year, for at least a year. So that's really handy. And it's actually recommended you leave it in the ethanol if you're not going to do anything with it for quite some time. So if you are continuing, then the ethanol will help to remove the water soluble contaminants such as proteins, lipids, and salts that were in the reagents that you've used to extract the RNA. So that's what the ethanol step is for. You want to add 1 milliliter of 75% ethanol. You're going to centrifuge it for 5 minutes at 7,500 by G. And then you want to remove the ethanol and air dry the pellet for 5 to 10 minutes. Then your next step is to redissolve the RNA in water so that you can use it in the subsequent applications. So this here, you want to use RNA's free or any molecular grade water such as nuclease free water or even deep sea treated water, because you want to avoid having any RNAs that will go ahead and degrade your RNA that you've extracted. And redissolving it can be a bit difficult, so you should incubate it in a water bath or heat block at 55 to 60 degrees Celsius for 10 to 15 minutes in order to fully redissolve the RNA. If the RNA hasn't fully dissolved, you will get an A to 60 ratio of less than 1.6 when you look at it spectrophotometry. So it will be an indication that you haven't fully dissolved it. And again, a nanodrop is a handy spectrophotometer that most labs have. So let's go quantify the RNA. I have a video on here showing you how to interpret nanodrop or spectrophotometer assessment of nucleic acids, and so you can go ahead and have a look at it. So what you're looking for here is an A to 80 ratio of around 1.8 is fine, and this is considered pure RNA. So the A to 60 is this is the ratio between your nucleic acids and proteins, and so if you have a good ratio, then it's considered pure. For more accuracy in your quantitation, you can go ahead and look at fluorescence-based assessments such as the qubit. And so here, a specific fluorescent dye that will bind DNA, or in our case RNA, will be used, and you are able to, you know, quantify. It doesn't give you an assessment of quality in terms of integrity of your RNA. This is why the nanodrop is kind of handy, because it gives you a rough idea of the integrity based on the 260-280 ratio. But the fluorescence-based assay is superior in terms of actual quantity because it will ignore any DNA contamination or single-stranded DNA that's in the system, that's in the sample. So as mentioned, I got 130 nanograms per microliter from my tiny pellet, and I had an A to 60 ratio of around 1.8, which is considered reasonable. So then I went on and I wanted to actually qualify it on an agarose gel, which is what's used for nucleic acid separation. You tend to use your SDS-based acrylamide gels for proteins, but for nucleic acids, agarose gels are used. I ran it at 1%. So for RNA, you're meant to use a denaturing gel where there's formamide in the system. And that's because RNA has tertiary structure like protein, and so it can form hairpins or tertiary structures that don't resolve well in a gel without some kind of agent that helps it to be linear. But I went ahead and ran it in a non-denatured environment. And in addition, I had read from this paper by Aranda et al. That I could actually use sodium hypochlorite in place of the formamide to keep my RNA linear for the separation. Unfortunately, in my hands, and I repeated this experiment 3 times, I could see that the sodium hypochlorite was not helping. In fact, it was degrading the RNA. And how do I know that? Because that ladder is a DNA ladder, and it actually degrades the DNA ladder. So yeah, I can't recommend using the sodium hypochlorite approach in place of the formamide. But as you can see, what I learned from this is that you actually need to load quite a bit to visualize on an agarose gel. So when I loaded less than 500 nanogram, as you can see, I couldn't visualize. It didn't stain. It didn't come up, even though I was using a sensitive cyber gold stain. The only time I could see it was when I loaded more than 500 nanogram. And I mean, this is nanodrop spectrophotometry assessment, so it's, again, over-exaggerating, but it gives you an idea that you need quite a bit. So how should it look? This is how it should look, and this image is credit to Animated Biology with Arpan. He, on his channel, he had actually shown a prep that had good quality RNA. And so you can see what you're looking for is 3 bands, which will indicate the quality of your RNA prep. The 2 that you mostly focus on are your 28S, is referred to as your 28S ribosomal RNA band, and then 18S ribosomal RNA band. And then sometimes you can visualize a 5S ribosomal RNA band. So why are these important? So the 28S and 18S ribosomal RNA bands are key components in the ribosome of eukaryotic cells, and they are commonly used as markers in RNA quality control. The 18S actually comes from a larger subunit, a 40S subunit. It's just a smaller portion of a 40S ribosome subunit in eukaryote, and it plays a key role in the recognition of messenger RNA during translation and helps in binding of messenger RNA to the ribosome in the initiation of protein synthesis. So you want to make sure that it's there and it's resolved well. Then the 28S is a component of a larger ribosome, again, a 60S subunit of the ribosome in eukaryote. The 28S ribosomal RNA's function is in the enzymatic function of the ribosome. It catalyzes the formation of peptide bonds between amino acids during protein synthesis. And so your ratio of 28S to 18S ribosomal RNA, if intact, is that the 28S will be larger, roughly twice as abundant as the 18S. And if it's degraded, then you will have a lower ratio between those two. And this is often observed when the RNA is fragmented or degraded. This ratio can be used to gauge the integrity. So a common marker of RNA degradation is that your 28S, 18S ratios will be not twice as you would expect. And so this happens when the RNA is fragmented or degraded. And that's how it helps you to gauge the integrity of your total RNA. Okay, so that's it for this video on how to assess the integrity of your extracted RNA. Well, extract the RNA and also check the integrity. If it's been useful, please give me a thumbs up, and I'll catch you in the next video. God bless. Bye.